November 15th through the 21st. Doctrine and Covenants, Sections 133 through 134. Prepare ye for the coming of the Bridegroom. President Henry B. Eyring taught, quote, "The restoration of the gospel started with a humble question pondered in a humble home, and it can continue in each of our homes," end quote. From a home where the Spirit of the Lord dwells, Ensigner Liahona, May 2019. When the church was barely 19 months old, the prophet Joseph Smith and other church leaders laid out ambitious plans to compile God's Latter-day Revelations into one volume and print 10,000 copies, double the first print run of the Book of Mormon. Unfortunately, high costs tempered these plans, and mobs attacked the church's press while printing was in progress. They scattered the unbound pages, and although courageous saints preserved some of them, no complete copies of the Book of Commandments are known to have survived. What we now know as Section 133 of the Doctrine and Covenants was meant to be the appendix to the Book of Commandments, like an exclamation point at the end of the Lord's published revelations. It warns of a coming day of judgment and re-echoes the call found throughout modern revelation. Flee worldliness, as symbolized by Babylon. Build Zion, prepare for the second coming, and spread this message unto every nation and kindred and tongue and people. See verse 37. While the original plans for the Book of Commandments were not fulfilled, this revelation is a reminder and a witness that the Lord's work cannot be thwarted, for he shall make bare his holy arm, and all the ends of the earth shall see the salvation of their God. See verse 3. Ideas for personal scripture study. Doctrine and Covenants, Section 133. The truths in the Doctrine and Covenants can prepare me to do God's work. Books sometimes end with a conclusion that restates or summarizes the book's main points. Section 133 was originally meant to be the conclusion of the Book of Commandments, and it might be valuable to read this section with that in mind. What points does the Lord emphasize about his work? What do verses 57 through 62 teach you about the role the Lord wants you to play in his work? Doctrine and Covenants, Section 133, verses 1 through 19. The Lord wants me to prepare for his second coming. Both Section 1, the Lord's Preface to the Doctrine and Covenants, and Section 133, the original appendix to the book, begin with the same plea from the Lord. Hearken, O ye people of my church. See Doctrine and Covenants, Section 1, verse 1, and Section 133, verse 1. What does it mean to hearken? See Guide to the Scriptures, Hearken, scriptures.churchofjesuschrist.org. What invitations or commands does the Lord want you to hearken to in Doctrine and Covenants, Section 133, verses 1 through 19? What are you inspired to do to better prepare for his coming? How will you help those around you to prepare? See also Matthew chapter 25, verses 1 through 13. D. Todd Christofferson, Preparing for the Lord's Return, Ensigner Liahona, May 2019. Doctrine and Covenants, Section 133, verses 19 through 56. The second coming will be joyful for the righteous. As you read in Doctrine and Covenants, Section 133, verses 19 through 32, about the events that will accompany the Savior's second coming, you might ponder what the descriptions of these events suggest to you about the Savior and his work. What possible spiritual applications can you find in these descriptions? As you read the description of the Savior's return in verses 32 through 56, what causes you to look forward to that great day? What words or phrases describe the Lord's love for his people? Consider recording your personal experiences with the loving kindness of your Lord and all that he has bestowed upon you according to his goodness. See verse 52. Doctrine and Covenants, Section 134. Governments were instituted of God for the benefit of man. The early saints' relationship with government was complex. When the saints were forced out of Jackson County, Missouri in 1833, they received no support or compensation from the local or national government despite their appeals for help. At the same time, some people outside the church interpreted teachings about Zion to mean that the saints rejected the authority of earthly governments. Doctrine and Covenants, Section 134, was written in part to clarify the church's position on government. How should church members feel about governments? As you study Section 134, consider making two lists. One list of principles you learn about government, and another of the responsibilities of citizens. How might these ideas have been helpful to the early saints? How are they applicable where you live? See also Articles of Faith, Chapter 1, verses 11 through 12. Gospel Topics, Religious Freedom, topics.churchofjesuschrist.org. Ideas for Family Scripture Study and Home Evening. Doctrine and Covenants, Section 133, verses 4 through 14. The spiritual opposite of Zion is Babylon, an ancient city that throughout Scripture symbolizes wickedness and spiritual bondage. See D. Todd Christofferson, Come to Zion, Ensign or Liahona, November 2008. Guide to the Scriptures, Babel, Babylon, scriptures.churchofjesuschrist.org. Is there anything you need to do as a family to, in a spiritual sense, go out from Babylon, see verse 5, and go forth unto Zion, see verse 9? Doctrine and Covenants, Section 133, verses 20 through 33. As you read these verses together, your family could draw pictures of what they think the Second Coming will be like. You could also play or sing a song about the Second Coming, such as When He Comes Again, Children's Songbook 82 through 83, and discuss what your family can do to prepare for His coming. Doctrine and Covenants, Section 133, verses 37 through 39. Would your family enjoy reading these verses with a loud voice? See verse 38. What does it mean to share the gospel with a loud voice? What truths can we share? Doctrine and Covenants, Section 134, verses 1 through 2. To help your family understand the importance of government, you could discuss questions like these. How is our family blessed by having rules? How is our country blessed by having laws? You could also make or color a picture of your country's flag or memorize the 11th and 12th Articles of Faith. For more ideas for teaching children, see this week's outline in Come Follow Me for Primary. Suggested song, Come Ye Children of the Lord, Hymns number 58. Improving personal study. Teach clear and simple doctrine. The Lord describes His gospel with words like plainness and simplicity. See Doctrine and Covenants, Section 133, verse 57. What do these words suggest to you about teaching the gospel to your family?
Section 133. Revelation given through Joseph Smith the prophet at Hiram, Ohio, November 3, 1831. Prefacing this revelation, Joseph Smith's history states, At this time there were many things which the elders desired to know relative to preaching the gospel to the inhabitants of the earth and concerning the gathering. And in order to walk by the true light and be instructed from on high, on the 3rd of November 1831, I inquired of the Lord and received the following important revelation. This section was first added to the Book of Doctrine and Covenants as an appendix and was subsequently assigned a section number. 1 through 6. The saints are commanded to prepare for the second coming. 7 through 16. All men are commanded to flee from Babylon, come to Zion, and prepare for the great day of the Lord. 17 through 35. He will stand on Mount Zion, the continents will become one land, and the lost tribes of Israel will return. 36 through 40. The gospel was restored through Joseph Smith to be preached in all the world. 41 through 51. The Lord will come down in vengeance upon the wicked. 52 through 56. It will be the year of His redeemed. 57 through 74. The gospel is to be sent forth to save the saints and for the destruction of the wicked.
Hearken, O ye people of my church, saith the Lord your God, and hear the word of the Lord concerning you. The Lord who shall suddenly come to His temple, the Lord who shall come down upon the world with a curse to judgment, yea, upon all the nations that forget God, and upon all the ungodly among you. For he shall make bare his holy arm in the eyes of all the nations, and all the ends of the earth shall see the salvation of their God. Wherefore, prepare ye, O my people. Sanctify yourselves, gather ye together, O ye people of my church, upon the land of Zion, all you that have not been commanded to tarry. Go ye out from Babylon, be ye clean that bear the vessels of the Lord. Call your solemn assemblies, and speak often one to another, and let every man call upon the name of the Lord. Yea, verily I say unto you again, the time has come when the voice of the Lord is unto you. Go ye out of Babylon, gather ye out from among the nations, from the four winds, from one end of heaven to the other. Send forth the elders of my church unto the nations which are afar off, unto the islands of the sea. Send forth unto foreign lands. Call upon all nations, first upon the Gentiles, and then upon the Jews. And behold, and lo, this shall be their cry, and the voice of the Lord unto all people. Go ye forth unto the land of Zion, that the borders of my people may be enlarged, and that her stakes may be strengthened, and that Zion may go forth unto the regions round about. Yea, let the cry go forth among all people, awake and arise, and go forth to meet the bridegroom. Behold, and lo, the bridegroom cometh. Go ye out to meet him. Prepare yourselves for the great day of the Lord. Watch, therefore, for ye know neither the day nor the hour. Let them, therefore, who are among the Gentiles, flee unto Zion. And let them who be of Judah flee unto Jerusalem, unto the mountains of the Lord's house. Go ye out from among the nations, even from Babylon, from the midst of wickedness, which is spiritual Babylon. But verily, thus saith the Lord, let not your flight be in haste, but let all things be prepared before you. And he that goeth, let him not look back, lest sudden destruction shall come upon him. Hearken and hear, O ye inhabitants of the earth. Listen, ye elders of my church together, and hear the voice of the Lord. For he calleth upon all men, and he commandeth all men everywhere to repent. For behold, the Lord God hath sent forth the angel, crying through the midst of heaven, saying, prepare ye the way of the Lord, and make his path straight, for the hour of his coming is nigh. When the Lamb shall stand upon Mount Zion, and with him 144,000, having his Father's name written on their foreheads. Wherefore, prepare ye for the coming of the bridegroom. Go ye out to meet him. For behold, he shall stand upon the Mount of Olivet, and upon the mighty ocean, even the great deep, and upon the islands of the sea, and upon the land of Zion. And he shall utter his voice out of Zion, and he shall speak from Jerusalem, and his voice shall be heard among all people. And it shall be a voice as the voice of many waters, and as the voice of a great thunder, which shall break down the mountains, and the valleys shall not be found. He shall command the great deep, and it shall be driven back into the north countries, and the islands shall become one land. And the land of Jerusalem and the land of Zion shall be turned back into their own place, and the earth shall be like as it was in the days before it was divided. And the Lord, even the Savior, shall stand in the midst of his people, and shall reign over all flesh. And they who are in the north countries shall come in remembrance before the Lord, and their prophets shall hear his voice, and shall no longer stay themselves. And they shall smite the rocks, and the ice shall flow down at their presence. And an highway shall be cast up in the midst of the great deep. Their enemies shall become a prey unto them. And in the barren deserts there shall come forth pools of living water, and the parched ground shall no longer be a thirsty land. And they shall bring forth their rich treasures unto the children of Ephraim, my servants. And the boundaries of the everlasting hills shall tremble at their presence. And there shall they fall down, and be crowned with glory, even in Zion, by the hands of the servants of the Lord, even the children of Ephraim. And they shall be filled with songs of everlasting joy. Behold, this is the blessing of the everlasting God upon the tribes of Israel, and the richer blessing upon the head of Ephraim and his fellows. And they also of the tribe of Judah, after their pain, shall be sanctified in holiness before the Lord, to dwell in his presence day and night, forever and ever. And now, verily saith the Lord, that these things might be known among you, O inhabitants of the earth, I have sent forth mine angel flying through the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel, who hath appeared unto some, and hath committed it unto man, who shall appear unto many that dwell on the earth. And this gospel shall be preached unto every nation, and kindred, and tongue, and people. And the servants of God shall go forth, saying with a loud voice, Fear God, and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment is come. And worship him that made heaven, and earth, and the sea, and the fountains of waters, calling upon the name of the Lord, day and night, saying, O that thou wouldst rend the heavens, that thou wouldst come down, that the mountains might flow down at thy presence. And it shall be answered upon their heads. For the presence of the Lord shall be as the melting fire that burneth, and as the fire which causeth the waters to boil. O Lord, thou shalt come down to make thy name known to thine adversaries, and all nations shall tremble at thy presence. When thou doest terrible things, things they look not for, yea, when thou comest down, and the mountains flow down at thy presence, thou shalt meet him who rejoiceth and worketh righteousness, who remembereth thee in thy ways. For since the beginning of the world have not men heard, nor perceived by the ear, neither hath any eye seen, O God, besides thee, how great things thou hast prepared for him that waiteth for thee. And it shall be said, Who is this that cometh down from God in heaven with dyed garments, yea, from the regions which are not known, clothed in his glorious apparel, traveling in the greatness of his strength? And he shall say, I am he who spake in righteousness, mighty to save. And the Lord shall be red in his apparel, and his garments like him that treadeth in the wine vat. And so great shall be the glory of his presence, that the sun shall hide his face in shame, and the moon shall withhold its light, and the stars shall be hurled from their places. And his voice shall be heard, I have trodden the winepress alone, and have brought judgment upon all people, and none were with me. And I have trampled them in my fury, and I did tread upon them in mine anger, and their blood have I sprinkled upon my garments, and stained all my raiment. For this was the day of vengeance which was in my heart. And now the year of my redeemed is come, and they shall mention the loving kindness of their Lord, and all that he has bestowed upon them, according to his goodness, and according to his loving kindness, forever and ever. In all their afflictions he was afflicted, and the angel of his presence saved them. And in his love, and in his pity, he redeemed them, and bore them, and carried them all the days of old. Yea, and Enoch also, and they who were with him, the prophets who were before him, and Noah also, and they who were before him, and Moses also, and they who were before him, and from Moses to Elijah, and from Elijah to John, who were with Christ in his resurrection, and the holy apostles, with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, shall be in the presence of the Lamb. And the graves of the saints shall be opened, and they shall come forth and stand on the right hand of the Lamb, when he shall stand upon Mount Zion, and upon the holy city, the New Jerusalem. And they shall sing the song of the Lamb, day and night, forever and ever. And for this cause, that men might be made partakers of the glories which were to be revealed, the Lord sent forth the fullness of his gospel, his everlasting covenant, reasoning in plainness and simplicity, to prepare the weak for those things which are coming on the earth, and for the Lord's errand in the day when the weak shall confound the wise, and the little one become a strong nation, and too shall put their tens of thousands to flight. And by the weak things of the earth the Lord shall thresh the nations by the power of his Spirit. And for this cause these commandments were given. They were commanded to be kept from the world in the day that they were given, but now are to go forth unto all flesh. And this, according to the mind and will of the Lord, who ruleth over all flesh. And unto him that repenteth and sanctifieth himself before the Lord shall be given eternal life. And upon them that hearken not to the voice of the Lord shall be fulfilled that which was written by the prophet Moses, that they should be cut off from among the people, and also that which was written by the prophet Malachi. For behold, the day cometh that shall burn as an oven, and all the proud, yea, and all that do wickedly, shall be stubble. And the day that cometh shall burn them up, saith the Lord of hosts, that it shall leave them neither root nor branch. Wherefore, this shall be the answer of the Lord unto them. In that day, when I came unto mine own, no man among you received me, and you were driven out. When I called again, there was none of you to answer. Yet my arm was not shortened at all, that I could not redeem, neither my power to deliver. Behold, at my rebuke, I dry up the sea. I make the rivers a wilderness, their fish stink, and die for thirst. I clothe the heavens with blackness, and make sackcloth their covering. And this shall ye have of my hand, ye shall lie down in sorrow. Behold, and lo, there are none to deliver you. For ye obeyed not my voice when I called to you out of the heavens. Ye believed not my servants, and when they were sent unto you, ye received them not. Wherefore, they sealed up the testimony and bound up the law, and ye were delivered over unto darkness. These shall go away into outer darkness, where there is weeping and wailing and gnashing of teeth. Behold, the Lord your God hath spoken it.
Section 134. A Declaration of Belief Regarding Governments and Laws in General, adopted by unanimous vote at a General Assembly of the Church, held at Kirtland, Ohio, August 17, 1835. Many saints gathered together to consider the proposed contents of the first edition of the Doctrine and Covenants. At that time, this declaration was given the following preamble: that our belief with regard to earthly governments and laws in general may not be misinterpreted nor misunderstood, we have thought proper to present at the close of this volume our opinion concerning the same. 1 through 4. Governments should preserve freedom of conscience and worship. 5 through 8. All men should uphold their governments and owe respect and deference to the law. 9 through 10. Religious societies should not exercise civil powers. 11 through 12. Men are justified in defending themselves and their property.
We believe that governments were instituted of God for the benefit of man, and that He holds men accountable for their acts in relation to them, both in making laws and administering them for the good and safety of society. We believe that no government can exist in peace except such laws are framed and held inviolate as will secure to each individual the free exercise of conscience, the right and control of property, and the protection of life. We believe that all governments necessarily require civil officers and magistrates to enforce the laws of the same, and that such as will administer the law in equity and justice should be sought for and upheld by the voice of the people, if a republic, or the will of the sovereign. We believe that religion is instituted of God, and that men are amenable to Him and to Him only for the exercise of it, unless their religious opinions prompt them to infringe upon the rights and liberties of others. But we do not believe that human law has a right to interfere in prescribing rules of worship, to bind the consciences of men, nor dictate forms for public or private devotion. That the civil magistrate should restrain crime but never control conscience, should punish guilt but never suppress the freedom of the soul. We believe that all men are bound to sustain and uphold the respective governments in which they reside, while protected in their inherent and inalienable rights by the laws of such governments, and that sedition and rebellion are unbecoming every citizen thus protected, and should be punished accordingly, and that all governments have a right to enact such laws as in their own judgments are best calculated to secure the public interest, at the same time, however, holding sacred the freedom of conscience. We believe that every man should be honored in his station, rulers and magistrates as such, being placed for the protection of the innocent and the punishment of the guilty, and that to the laws all men owe respect and deference, as without them peace and harmony would be supplanted by anarchy and terror. human laws being instituted for the express purpose of regulating our interests as individuals and nations between man and man, and divine laws given of heaven, prescribing rules on spiritual concerns for faith and worship, both to be answered by man to his Maker. We believe that rulers, states, and governments have a right and are bound to enact laws for the protection of all citizens in the free exercise of their religious belief. But we do not believe that they have a right in justice to deprive citizens of this privilege or proscribe them in their opinions, so long as a regard and reverence are shown to the laws, and such religious opinions do not justify sedition nor conspiracy. We believe that the commission of crime should be punished according to the nature of the offense, that murder, treason, robbery, theft, and the breach of the general peace, in all respects, should be punished according to their criminality and their tendency to evil among men by the laws of that government in which the offense is committed. And for the public peace and tranquility, all men should step forward and use their ability in bringing offenders against good laws to punishment. We do not believe it just to mingle religious influence with civil government, whereby one religious society is fostered and another proscribed in its spiritual privileges and the individual rights of its members as citizens denied. We believe that all religious societies have a right to deal with their members for disorderly conduct according to the rules and regulations of such societies, provided that such dealings be for fellowship and good standing. But we do not believe that any religious society has authority to try men on the right of property or life, to take from them this world's goods, or to put them in jeopardy of either life or limb, or to inflict any physical punishment upon them. They can only excommunicate them from their society and withdraw from them their fellowship. We believe that men should appeal to the civil law for redress of all wrongs and grievances, where personal abuse is inflicted, or the right of property or character infringed, where such laws exist as will protect the same. But we believe that all men are justified in defending themselves, their friends and property, and the government, from the unlawful assaults and encroachments of all persons in times of exigency, where immediate appeal cannot be made to the laws and relief afforded. We believe it just to preach the gospel to the nations of the earth and warn the righteous to save themselves from the corruption of the world. But we do not believe it right to interfere with bondservants, neither preach the gospel to, nor baptize them, contrary to the will and wish of their masters, nor to meddle with or influence them in the least to cause them to be dissatisfied with their situations in this life, thereby jeopardizing the lives of men. Such interference we believe to be unlawful and unjust, and dangerous to the peace of every government, allowing human beings to be held in